Welcome to Intersections, once again on Thursday, and a slightly different format, at least for the first half of the show, because my co-host and partner, Brian, is going to join us at the top of the hour. So this is an example of trust in the new economy, I guess you could say, because I'm going to be flying solo interviewing our first guest, Helen Lee. But before I do, let me just remind you that Intersections is a weekly conversational jam session every 10:30 a.m. Pacific, where we look at the intersections among technology, innovation, culture, and ideas. And that gives us a great hunting license to go out and find amazing people from all walks of the innovation economy who have something to say for themselves and something to say that will benefit us in terms of providing foresight into where things are going. Because as we know, we're in an age not just of disruption, but really of discontinuity, where the maps that formerly used to guide us to very obvious destinations no longer really apply. And so I guess you could say the fun part of being alive in this era is that we have to become very good map designers. And in a sense, everyone who comes on the show as a guest is their own version of a map designer showing us where the desired future of their particular area of passion is. So just also to remind you that we'd love to hear from you in the chat and know where you're tuning in from, so to speak, if I can use an old-fashioned broadcast term. We are privileged both in the live as well as the asynchronous audience to now have thousands of viewers from all over the world. And that's one of the most gratifying parts of doing the show. Brian Solis, my co-host, I'll introduce him briefly, is the global chief evangelist for innovation at Salesforce and has had a long and storied career of linking digital to innovation, to marketing, to organizational development. He was really a digital guy before digital was really a thing. Broadcasts his insights through books, through keynotes, through workshops, and also through intersections. And then I, as his colleague and co-host, have had a 35-year, I would say, history of being obsessed by the topics of business creativity, innovation, and entrepreneurship, which I taught for 14 years at Harvard Business School. But as you can see from the background here, I've been immersed in a whole bunch of creative activities, music, playing music with Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention back in the 60s, producing feature films and Broadway theater, starting companies. So a very eclectic clinical as well as theoretical exposure to the realities of innovation and more importantly, how innovation works. So please find us on intersectionslive.com, which will take you to the archive. You know, we view our videos as being evergreen, and therefore you have the benefit of going back and looking over all of the great conversations that we've had. We are in the process of organizing a newsletter via Substack, and there are going to be special events of various kinds. I think the cultural and musical, you know, I have a bias towards music, obviously, aspect is going to feature a bit more prominently over the next few months as we bring in some very interesting artists to bear. And we have today a person who has had an enormous impact on enabling arts and musical arts, multimedia arts in an artistic way, and is quite the artist herself, Helen Lee. So we'll get there a moment. And in fact, I think this is probably the right time to bring on our first guest, Helen Lee.
Hello, thank you for having me. It's a real pleasure to be on your show, John.
Well, it's delightful to have you, and it's delightful to see you again. Just as a word of background, I met Helen virtually, like we're meeting most people these days, when we were can we say judges? That sounds very imposing.
I think that's what let's say judges, you know.
We didn't have to
prep. Yeah.
We didn't have to put on black robes and our headpieces, but we were at the MIDI association competition for the most innovative MIDI developments of the year. And for those of you that don't know the acronym, MIDI stands for Musical Instrument Digital Interface and is the kind of lingua franca that allows bands to hook up their digital instruments to digital workstations, and really is the way that digital instruments of all kinds are able to connect with production environments, with sequencers, with all of the above. And MIDI is actually moving beyond the container of music strictly defined into many other directions as well. So so we had a chance to meet, and I would love to start, Helen, by just having you say a bit about what's really on top of mind, what you're most excited about now. Just as background, Helen's a musical and creative technology maven. You can see from the kind of poster board back there that she's got all of these tools. So there's a very kind of objective aspect to her passion for music technologies, and I guess what she would call experimental electronics. She's the head of community at a company called CrowdSupply, which is a crowdfunding platform for what is described as open ethical hardware. Very interestingly, she designs musical instruments. So we want to hear more about that, and has written a lot about DIY music tech, and writes regularly for Maker Magazine, and is just the most a terrific example of intersections in terms of all of the different aspects of technology, culture, arts, and design. Anyway, so enough of me. How about we turn it over to you, Helen?
What did you want me to talk about? Yes, hello. What an introduction. What an introduction to live up to as well. Yeah, thank you for mentioning my workshop. I have just been building it out. I just immigrated to the US, so I've had to rebuild my workstation, and I'm pretty happy with how it's coming along. I've pretty much replaced all my tools now. It's very exciting. And I've got some new ones too. I've just got a new 3D printer, which I've been having a lot of fun with as well. So yeah, it's all coming together quite nicely. I do tend to work in the intersections of a lot of different things. In fact, it's kind of a joke almost between like artists who work with technology. It's just like, oh yes, I work at the intersection of art and technology, just like everybody else who makes weird tech and you don't really know what to do with them. You're like, they're a creative technologist? I'm just a weirdo who uses computing and electronics to make fun things. And sometimes useful things too, yeah.
Well, we need more weirdos in the world. And I guess that prompts me to ask you a question. How does the creative process work for you? You know, obviously at some point something sparks in your head and it's a creative idea. You have a lot of left brain chops in terms of the engineering and the making of things, but creativity also requires a lot of right brain and intuitive, you know, comfort with uncertainty and so forth and so on. So how does it work for you? I mean, what's the journey by which you originate something new?
You know, a lot of people ask me this because the things that I make are quite unusual in some ways. People are like, how did that even pop into your mind? And I think like creativity is a skill, it's a muscle, just like any other. You know, I get better at coding by practicing coding and working on projects, and I get better at coming up with creative ideas by making creative ideas. You know, it's not like some kind of crown that's placed upon your head, like, yes, you are creative. It's a skill that you have to, well, you know this, it's a skill that you have to practice like any other. But in terms of like how I come up with my project ideas, I mean, aside from the regularly practicing my creative, you know, flexing my creative muscles, I'm actually very materials driven. So I'm very inspired by going into shops where you wouldn't necessarily normally find an electronics enthusiast. So I've been known to wander around supermarkets with my multimeter. I go around fabric shops looking for metallic brocade so that I can carry the signal in an unconventional way. A lot of the things that I've made have actually been made with materials that are designed for like architecture modeling or, you know, things that you wouldn't necessarily normally find in an electronic enthusiast's toolbox. So yeah, I like to be observant of the things that are around me and be curious about how they might work as well. So basically, you know, like once you get a certain feel for things, you can think, oh, that looks nice. I wonder if it's, I wonder if it's adequately conductive. And then you end up having some really interesting things where you find the materials and you're hacking them essentially into something that they weren't supposed to do. And I find that very amusing. I've actually got a couple of examples here. Sure. So this is something that I made. I thought I'd show them because like it's all very well talking about experimental electronics, but somebody who's not into that kind of stuff is like, what on earth does that mean? That's just word salad. So what I mean is something like, I've got a couple of makes. So this is something from my book. This is a giant cuddly tentacle that you stroke. And then when you stroke it, it's actually embroidered, machine embroidered with conductive thread. And then I've got that wired up to a whole bunch of electronics on the inside. So when I stroke this, my tentacle plushy pet, it purrs into my headphones. Mm. And it's just the most lovely, comforting, ridiculous, fun little thing that everybody really likes. So like that's an experimental. It's basically a pillow that I've made into a sensor. Which was quite fun. I was actually inspired exactly by the materials in that one. I was like, oh, wow, that's really cool. It was like this embossed cotton. It's like, I don't remember what you call this kind of texture, but the texture of this cotton is all really puckered, and it reminded me of the suckers on an octopus's tentacle. And I was like, oh, it'd be cool to make a giant fluffy octopus tentacle that you could cuddle. And then I made it purr because why not? But another thing that I did that it was very much inspired by materials this is my golden disco ball theremin, which is also a MIDI controller, which I thought you might enjoy.
Yeah.
So it's not plugged in, obviously. But yeah, so this is a theremin I made that's also a golden disco ball. This is when I was living in Berlin. I went to my local craft store. And I saw these beautiful golden squares, and I was like, you know what? I've never made a disco ball, and I think I could make a cool instrument out of a disco ball. So it was just a spur of the moment thing that was inspired by some cool materials that I saw that I thought, oh, that might be applicable for this other thing. I just let my mind go where it will, and just like, yeah, I try and be present when I'm in these interesting stores or in an art gallery or something. Just so I'm looking at texture, I'm looking at material, I'm looking at construction. I love going to art galleries and working out how the artist made things. I love to actually when I used to teach, I taught graduate and postgraduate students in London, and when I used to teach, I did a course on play and electronics, which was amazing, so fun. And I would take all my students to like arcade games and arcade galleries and like try and get them to work out how things were put together. So I just have like, I'm just practiced at thinking about how things work in their most distilled sense. Like, oh, that uses this input, that uses that output. So like you can figure out a way of doing something. And then, yeah, I just let myself get inspired by being present in places where I am and being very mindful of, like, what material exists and, like, looking at other people's art and just, you know, just having that spirit of curiosity. And then, yeah. So.
Yeah, it's really interesting. You know, very revealing, too. Levi Strauss, the anthropologist, said that one approach to understanding was to collect a bunch of things and use that as a device for making sense of the universe, as opposed to starting from a priori rational framework and then trying to make everything fit into it. He called it bricolage, which is basically collecting. And it sounds like you're cool hunting and going out there and tuning your curiosity and your gut feel without necessarily having a specific purpose for the immediate object of your curiosity, bringing them back to your workshop. So I can see that having a workshop is very important for your process.
Yeah.
But interesting,
incredibly important.
It is very, a studio environment or whatever. Mm. But then also you have the rational side. I mean, I noticed that your workshop's very neat and things are-
It is very neat. I have the neatest, every electronics engineer is like, how is your bench this neat? Like mine's covered in components. And I'm like, I don't know, it's just neat. I like it to be clean before I can make something new.
Well, that's a noble tradition, which is, you know, painting the walls of the gallery white before you have a new show or going to the place or whatever. But a lot of people who are good at collecting and good at being comfortable with their instincts are not the most orderly people, right? Because it's really the appetite for disorder that allows them to be curious, and then they bring it back and it just piles up, right? And you seem to have the ability to be very effective on both gear settings, which is unusual, I would say.
I think the thing, I actually really value minimalism aesthetically, and I'm not sure it's even remotely possible to be minimalist and into electronics and tinkering, but I do like to curate, and my aesthetic in terms of like the objects that I make are usually quite, I mean, yeah, they usually have a simplicity to them. I like to distill things down to that simplicity. It gives my mind calm as well. Like I mean, particularly over the last year, I've been really suffering from anxiety, and honestly, I feel like having a calm space where I feel able to create, or where I feel able to think, I guess, really, that's what it comes down to, right? Is that space in my mind to think. So for me, like having a clean area that is aesthetically pleasing to me, and being inspired, you know, being surrounded by objects that I find pleasing, is actually very important to me, to my mental health, actually, if I'm being perfectly honest with you. I find it very important. In fact, like a lot of my work is informed by that. The tentacle that I showed you earlier, I actually made that when I was having really bad problems with depression, and I wanted to feel comforted, you know. I wanted to create something that was kind and loving and non-judgmental, and that I was able to practice affection for. So actually that was the root of my tentacle, was just this need to create technology that made me feel a certain way. Like a lot of my technology is very emotional, actually. Like I am quite, as you said, like I don't set out at the beginning with a specific plan. I'm not like, oh, I'm going to make this thing because it's going to, you know, it talks about this meme, or like, you know, or like it's trendy or current or whatever. Like I don't ever plan my makes like that. I'm very much more, I'm fluid, and things can change in one whole session. Like I'm very quick to pivot on an idea. And part of that is because I'm quite lazy, to be honest with you.
What do you mean? What we're talking about?
So, I mean, what I would say is, like, to be honest, I think one of my strengths is, like, I'm not the best coder. Like, I am self-taught, or I don't believe in anything. There's no such thing as self-taught. Like, I'm like self-taught, but, like, I'm the inner, you know, I'm like a millennial. So I have, you know, I've been part of the internet. So, like, really, what self-taught means to me is, like, I didn't go to a traditional educational institution to learn any of my technical skills. I learned them in maker spaces and hacker spaces and at my friends' kitchens, but also I learned them on Twitter and I learned them on YouTube. So like, whilst people do describe me as like self-taught because I don't have that background, you know, I've been taught by the internet and hacker culture.
The universe brought you the knowledge that you need just in time. Yeah,
exactly. But because of that non-traditional background, though, there are some times where I'm like, oh, I've got a bit of a gap here. Like, you know, like I didn't understand this. You know, just last night I was working on a new thing that I'm working on, and I didn't understand one of the Python coding concepts that I came across. So I was like, what on earth? What's this statement? So I had to go away and like educate myself a little bit. But in the end, you know, like I often will, because I'm not like, you know, I don't have like 10 years professional coding experience, I will often find very, very simple ways to do something that isn't necessarily, you know, like, you know, so I'll be like, okay, well, I can't, you know, I can't do this. So I'll have to figure out a way of doing this with all the skills that I do have. And, you know, like you have to push yourself forward each time. But because I don't have like elite level coding skills, I have to be, I mean, I call myself lazy as a joke. Really, what I'm trying to be is efficient. and to be able to use the knowledge that I have in an effective way, right?
You know, so gaps are, gaps can be interesting. You know, you come up against something where there's a, you know, a void or a discontinuity, and it it can kind of put you in a different frame of mind to solve a different problem for what you, from what you originally set out to do. So we have about 10 minutes left. What I want to do is kind of shift the magnification a little bit and get your sense of, you know, where are we going with all of this kind of experimental technology and music, let's say, and music in the expanded sense of all the things that music now touches, which is not just sticking it in your CD, but, you know, live performance and, you know, multi-sensory kind of art. Where do you think it's all going now? And where do you see it from your vantage point in the
That's a really interesting question. And it's one that I've been thinking about a lot recently. So as I said, I recently moved, and I moved here from Berlin. And if you'll excuse me, I'll take this tale back. To answer the question about the future, I'm going to take a little dip into the past.
Okay.
So there's a wonderful museum in Berlin, which is the Museum of Musical Instruments. And I went in one day, and during the pandemic, you know, so there's like nobody, almost nobody there. I got this this curator showed me around. She was a specialist in harpsichords, and she showed me around the harpsichord section of this history, and the breadth of different instruments was absolutely mind-boggling. And because a harpsichord was would have been made to order, this was pre-globalization and pre, like, you know, industrialization of manufacturing. So it would be individualistic, right? So there'd be like a mother and daughter harpsichord. There would be a harpsichord stood on its edge, like for a particularly small space. Like, it would be made by craftspeople who would customize these things, right? Of course, it was so expensive back then. In fact, the reason the harpsichord fell out of favor was because of the French Revolution and the pianoforte. So the harpsichord was like so intertwined with the concept of high courts, right? And in fact, they showed the piano grande to one of the kings, I think one of the ones they ended up executing. And he was like, no, I don't like the piano. The harpsichord is much more refined. So when he was, you know, offed, everybody got rid of their harpsichords because they were seen to be a symbol that you were part of, like, the upper classes, these classes that reject the, you know, the new bourgeoisie. So that's how the piano became really, really popular. And it was really interesting to me to hear her talk about all of this, like, history of these instruments and the individualizations of them. And then we got upstairs to the piano and the modern musical instruments, and her expression turned. She was like, the globalization of instruments, you know, like, everybody plays the same violin now, everybody plays the same cello, it's all really boring, blah, blah, blah. And I've never really thought about it that way. But of course, our instruments, like our traditional classical instruments, are a result of globalization. You know, like, we didn't have until the 1940s or maybe early 1950s even like a unified idea of what the note A was. That was decided, you know, like A was decided to be like 440 hertz. Like in the 1940s, like, so this this kind of like homogenization and globalization of Western music is a relatively new phenomenon. And anyway, kind of back to your original question, that kind of inspires me for the future. I'm thinking, like, what it would be like if instead of using this, everybody using the same instruments, everybody was empowered to create their own version of instruments that fitted with their own artistic inclinations. And I see that happening already in the hacker culture. So I belong to a loose family of people called Hackoustic, and we're a group of London music hackers who make our own instruments and play our own instruments as well. So this kind of stuff would not have been accessible to people like me, people like my friends, random people on the internet 10, 20 years ago. But because of the democratization of code, essentially, of create, of being able to create with code as a tool, not as a programmer, I mean, that you're using code as a tool to create something else. It's so much easier. We've got amazing access to information. The hardware that we use to create these things is so much cheaper these days. Like, you can get started for, you know, like $10 to $15 and you're doing something incredible, you know, that would not have been remotely possible if you weren't an expert 20 years ago. You know, so there's this mass democratization of technology, this mass democratization of the information around that technology, and also a drive to simplify that. So I would love to see a return to boutique music making, but one that's not just for the rich, one that is truly accessible and truly customizable. And when we don't think about the things that we play as a product, we think, or as a, you know, like this black box, right? We don't understand what's happening. I really like the idea of this returning to the boutique, returning to the individualized, removing ourselves from the homogenized instruments and starting to express ourselves with our tools as well as the instruments we are given. So,
do you think there's or to what extent do you think there's an appetite for what you're describing? I mean, we know that the appetite for consuming music has never been greater in the era of streaming and so forth and so on. But a lot of people moan and groan about the fact that the kind of discipline that's required to learn an instrument in the analog era, where, you know, the violin or the piano, it would take 5 to 10 years before you really got to the good stuff, right? And now you can buy a an Ableton push or a pad of some kind, and you start pushing buttons, which my friend Tim Brown, who used to run IDEO, called the difference between making music, performing music versus designing music, that you didn't really have to have performative skills in order to push buttons. You could just organize the music in real time. But even that, you know, I wonder, to what extent do you think there is a widespread appetite for music making and this democratization of the tool set?
Look, it's not a set. Not everybody's going to be interested in it. Yeah, my point is like that, you know, like going forward, anybody who's interested in it is going to be able to do it regardless of their level of training, much like a violin, right? So, you know, like if you, it's the equivalent, right, of the Ableton push is the microcontroller. It's like, okay, cool. I can plug these things in here and I can do that. And it does that, you know, it is, of course, it's not as plug and play as the Ableton controller yet, but you know, things are considerably easier. So if there is an interest, it is possible for you to do it now. But yeah, I mean, I think instruments will become simpler and more complex is the answer to that, because different folks want different things out of their music making experience. I think, you know, it doesn't have to be traditional music for, you know, for it to be worthwhile and beautiful. And I think, as long as, you know, noise making is a human activity. Like, you know, from the very dawn of time, we've been making noise, and we will continue making noise with whatever's around us. You know, we will find ways to make noises and make instruments. Like, all music is made up, and every single instrument is an invention that has been through an iteration process. The violin wasn't just like magically birthed. You know, someone made that up. It came from a previous iteration of something. You know, like what we can see is like, you know, like a violin, like it didn't really even exist until the 13th century, you know, and then it's gone through many, many different iterations. And I think we'll continue to see that both with the existing traditional instruments that we have now, but also with, like, you know, using this new democratized technology to augment and to help even. I mean, I see quite a lot of instruments that use traditional instruments, but are adapted using new technology to be more accessible to play. For example, you know, like a bass that, if you know, like that does the fretting for you. If you've got reduced mobility. And I think, you know, like as long as you're getting joy, I think there's so much gatekeeping around music about what is and what isn't an instrument. I'm just like, let people have fun. Let people make noise. Like, if it sounds shit, so what? Like, so what? So did Musique Concrète, and look what happened to them. Like, they changed the face of the music industry. But let me tell you, it sounded terrible. So, like, don't worry if it sounds bad. If you're having a nice time, like, I think that's to be encouraged. We need to just remove this gatekeeping, remove this snobbery about what is real and isn't real.
Well, it's also the snobbery formal music education, right? I mean, you know, we have a very big social institution, which is about training young people in musical skills. And then if you go to a conservatory, you're being groomed to, you know, play Chopin ballades on stage. And, you know, there's this pyramid of achievement, which is quite broad. Yeah. Right? So only the good ones get to the top. And it has very little to do with inculcating the love of music or curiosity about music in the broad suite of the population.
But also, it's not just the top of the pyramid that make music. Everything else counts as music making, like from your local folk band in your pub, in your, you know, to the little experiments that you make. You know, it's all part of the fabric of musical innovation. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just experimentation. And I agree, like this top, this little top triangle of professionally trained musicians aren't the only ones who get to do it. You know, and but I mean, go back to the Ableton push though. I mean, I would like to see a move away. I mean, like, if I was like got my wish, I would love to see a move away from these kind of static button pushing things, you know. And just anything is particularly imaginative. I worked with Imogen Heap on her. So there's the Mimu glove, which is an expressive gesture controlling, which will, you know, it's essentially an Ableton push device. It does things when you do certain things. So instead of pushing a button, its inputs are an accelerometer on your hand, and various sensors, yes, you know, finger sensors and so on. But I would love to see a move towards that kind of expressive, and it's more performative as well. I'm a big fan of gesture-based music. That's a project I worked on. Not the grown-up glove. I was the lead dev on there's a children's version of the glove where children made an accelerometer-based gesture-controlled glove that made chiptune music, but like it was a kit, so the kids like coded it themselves, all that kind of stuff. It was really cute.
You know, I could talk with you for hours because I think we barely scratched the surface. But I think we're going to have to stop in just a second. By the way, have you ever visited the Musical Instrument Museum in Phoenix?
I have not been to Phoenix, full stop.
Well, there are very few reasons for visiting Phoenix, in my humble opinion. But one of the big ones is, anyway, I'll send you a link because I think it would augment your collector curiosity for new material. So with that, thank you so much. That was really terrific. That was like a shower of inspiration and mind opening. And I look forward to continuing our conversation because I think we have a lot to talk about.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Thank you so much, John.
Yeah. Okay. Take care. Bye. Well, that was something. So we are going to shift gears, although I think a lot of the themes will be resonant and actually bring from backstage our producer, Gregarious Narain, who is waving, hey, who has, I don't even know if you could say it's a day job or a night job or a twilight or dawn job. I mean, you know, like many of us, he's doing multiple things. But Gregarious has just launched a company and an application called Zealous, which, like many things out there, you know, when you first hear about Clubhouse or you first hear about Ecomi or something like that, it takes a while for your brain to just kind of swallow it and digest it so that it becomes a part of your familiar landscape. And I am racing, like many of us, to understand Zealous because I think it's going to be very significant. So anyway, first of all, Gregarious, welcome to the front of the stage from the back of the stage. Gregarious has a distinguished career as a serial and I guess sometimes parallel entrepreneur, has been involved in social media, blogging, podcasting, dealing with social media marketing since the inception. So like Brian, in a sense, he has been on the pioneering forefront of a lot of the big trends there. I could say a lot more about your background, but I think we want to get to the heart of it. So Gregarious, what is Zealous, and what prompted you to invest the time and energy to get it launched?
Well, thanks for having me, as usual. You know, it's good to be in the front of the house this time a little bit. So, John, I think, by the way, fascinating conversation. I don't play any instruments, but I follow a lot of people who create music because I find it super intriguing. But relative to, I guess, like where Zealous is going, I think we're entering a new generation in sort of the social realm, right? And if we look at the historical past of like social media, it was static published content, right? So we went from posts and I'm trying to get Brian the code so he can get in. we went from like things like posts and photos and videos and stuff like that, right? To the transitionary tool would be like what I would call stories, which sort of had that kind of, you experience them now, they're kind of real timey because of the time limits that sort of were on them. And they were also kind of tended to be live in some nature or video. Sorry, I'm just trying to get Brian a code. And so I think like where we're going now though, or where we've arrived at is basically this next generation, which is like what we're calling live, right? Which is this real-time synchronous experience of stuff as opposed to sort of this asynchronous experience of content, right? This didn't happen because of like Clubhouse and things like that. This happened because of, this was happening with things like Twitch, where we were having gaming. And then obviously we've been live streaming here, right, to multiple destinations. And today every major platform has some version of going live, right? Like LinkedIn, Twitch, et cetera, right? Twitter and whatnot. I think when we saw the next tools arrive though, like Clubhouse, Twitter Spaces, the audio sort of spaces, they took some of the heaviness off of what live meant, right? Because today live, people experience live as this, right? These kind of published streams that you're consuming sort of in a video format. I look at live as all encompassing. Right? Like technically live, even if you're chatting, is still live, right? Like you have to look at it and participate in it. And it's somewhat active. And so there's not necessarily the requirement that you be synchronous, that you be fully actively engaged in it. However, there we go. I don't know what the best format here is.
Brian Solis, ladies and gentlemen.
Brian's here.
This way.
So I think what's happened though, is that when you look at the ecosystem, we've built there's a huge industry around the tooling, and the business models around static content, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, it's the tradition. That's the legacy.
But what are the analogs now for this new environment where we're live, right? So I'll give you a very simple example. It's normal to run ads interstitially inside of static or, you know, sort of asynchronous content, but it is extremely disruptive to even imagine the idea of interrupting a live audio chat, say, like with an ad in the middle of it,
right?
And so I think like what ends up happening is we have to start to reimagine the tools and the business opportunities that exist as more people go live, right? So that we can start to create an ecosystem and an economy that I think provides a new avenues to support the creators themselves.
So how does that then relate to Zealous? What does Zealous do as an answer to these questions?
Great question. So Zealous is a live community platform, Brian's here. And so what it actually does is it provides four key capabilities, right? The first is the homepage, which is like a router for all of your live activity. Because, you know, people are going live in multiple platforms and a lot of fans miss those opportunities, right? So we built a homepage that gives you all these components to let you express yourself and guide or route people to the right place at the right time. Mm-hmm. The second thing we do, which is just an important part of the general ecosystem for creators, is what we call the live audience, which is actually by capturing and building your database and your fan base of actual fans. Because the second thing that we truly do believe in is ultimately creator and platform independence, such that creators can actually build a business on their own, independent, not in isolation of the existing platforms, but also independent of them, right? Mm-hmm. So I look at that universe as you go live everywhere else, and that's your opportunity to generate new interest, new viewers, new fans, etc. But then we look at Zealous as that place where you bring your most engaged fans and have these better, deeper conversations. The tools Brian's showing right there are the live streaming tools. So these are actually the live environment, right? So we provide a set of tools that can be used in conjunction with your existing live streams or a fully hosted environment. And much like on a Clubhouse or something like that, or kind of like we do in StreamYard, Here, like when we go live, we can bring anyone up in the audience and actually engage with them in real time. So it has a lot more intimacy. It's more inclusive, right? And it's definitely a more engaging sort of way to actually be live than we currently usually are experiencing. We call it one-to-one to everyone, right? Because you can have a number of small one-to-one engagements with your top fans, but then drive it to everybody at the same time still. And they can still be, you know, collaboratively part of that process, even if they're not fundamentally part of it in the front end. And then the fourth part is the monetization, right? So the business models that exist around live are, you know, I think they overlap the ones that exist in static content, but they add new ones, right? So for example, we have tipping, we have ticketing, and we have subscriptions. And our vision for creators with Zealous is ultimately to say, why don't you go subscribe to be part of conversations that I host and hold in a more regular way, right? So join my weekly, you know, salon on topic X, join my Q&A or AMA session on Fridays, right? Join my private interview series where I talk to, you know, some of the best people I know, but in a more intimate manner. And you're paying a subscription for access to great conversations, interactivity, and ultimately a sense of belonging.
And this is up and running, now, the turning real time into revenue platform and so on?
The revenue parts we're testing right now, but the rest is all there. Interestingly enough, revenue was not the thing that people wanted first. They first wanted actually that intimacy, as I call it, that sort of comes from being able to be closer to their fans. And then I think the monetization flows naturally from creating that space and that opportunity.
And tickets could also be coupons or promos or...
We will allow that. Yeah, we'll have stuff to support that over time for sure. Right now we think like, so I'll give you an example. I run a room on Clubhouse every morning called Get Unstuck, right? And it's an office hours with a bunch of great friends and experts, right? And we help other entrepreneurs and founders that are stuck in some part of their journey, you know, becoming an entrepreneur. Now, that room is in public. There's 200, 250 people, you know, there together. Now, not everybody, one, wants to share everything publicly, and not everybody, two, can get undivided time or attention from, say, any of those people who are up there. So with Zealous, what we could do is we could take that broad community and say, great, we're going to do a mastermind, and you're going to be in a group of six. And so you can see how that funnel starts to convert. And it's like the classic consulting model, I guess, that the closer you want to get to an individual, the more expensive, but also the more direct and guided that advice may be, mm-hmm. right? So one-on-one sessions would be one opportunity. Group sessions would be another. Premium content just in general is another valence sort of around this, right? And then of course there's the free content that anyone could be participatory in.
And is the content interactive content? So could you put a course or a learning experience in there, or is it content like an inventory of videos and PDF?
That's a good question. So we don't structure the content per se today, mm-hmm. right? So I'll give you an example though. What we've heard is there are people who have already packaged courses, mm-hmm. and what they want to do is offer office hours using Zealous alongside those courses that you're buying and participating in at your own pace, right? So mm-hmm. you buy a $1,500 How to Become a Web Developer course, and then on Fridays I have office hours, but it's only available in Zealous to the people who've actually purchased that course. And they may use a code or give them a private URL that they could participate in, right? So that is an avenue. It could also be like, if you've developed an episodic, a serialized or guided program, you may program out like your 12 weeks. Here's what each session is going to be. And much like we run our show, we don't need any actual tooling inside of our system or our platform. We provide that as humans on top of it.
So it seems like this will open up the world to a lot of people who up until now have not had an opportunity to aggregate a community around their personal creative campfire, and certainly have not had the tools to create memberships that might be amenable to monetization.
Absolutely. I think that's absolutely right, John, because here's what I actually think is there's sort of this power law, much like with expertise, right? Like where we have top thought leaders in every domain, but there are actually really great, amazing, qualified, experienced people all the way through that spectrum, right? And absolutely what you're saying is, I believe there's a huge middle that is like unrequited at this point, right? Yeah. Like, and for example, like I think like the people on that are being successful on Clubhouse, they're like a person like me. I'm not a visual creator. I'm not like a person who trades in that sort of area or domain. I tried it, didn't work for me, right? I can write, but like I feel like writing doesn't give me the opportunity to be reactive and share the true wealth of knowledge I have, because like I tend to bundle thoughts when you write as opposed to packaging experience like in the way that conversation draws it out, mm-hmm. right? And so I think there's a huge ecosystem of untapped experts and small micro influencers, nano influencers from all domains that are available. Let me give you an anecdote. Right now, if you want to monetize going live, you basically have two choices, right? It's either you go on OnlyFans and it tends to be like adult oriented content, or you go on Twitch and it tends to be gaming oriented content. That's about 2 million creators out of 50 million. So what happens to all those people in the middle? Right? You've got Instagrammers, you've got TikTokers, you got LinkedIn Live people, you got folks like us who do Facebook, YouTube, et cetera, multi-streamers. We're not monetizing this mm-hmm. per se. We do this because we love it and we want to share our insights and our passion, but that should lead to more opportunities and deeper engagements. And that's what we're trying to unlock with Zealous, is to find and identify those people and then create the opportunities for everyone.
You know, there are a lot of people that are in the business of providing courses, you know, like Podia, where, you know, it's easy to set up a course and create a paywall and do all that kind of stuff. But I think where they fall down, and they even talk about membership models and things like that, but where they fall down is exactly where what your sweet spot is, which is enabling a rich, interactive experience and interface with the community and monetizing that, whether it be, and you know, the metaphor that I think really applies to your situation is masterclass, right? So, you know, if you're a musician, a masterclass, you have the guru and you got five or six great, practitioners who are already advanced, but then you're taught, it's like your get unstuck thing, right?
Yeah.
And you can't have that experience in a fixed course. And you can't add, and so therefore there's a big opportunity to also be a complement to a lot of what already exists out there.
Well, absolutely. And I think one of the problems, John, that you're pointing out though, is that not everyone has a course in them, just like not everyone has a book in them, right? You can be an expert, but not have the will, the time, the patience, the skills, the connectivity to go and deliver those pieces. It's a huge risk, right? Like, you spend a long time writing a book. Most people who've written a book will tell you, you don't make your money back from the book.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Just much like building a course, you know, you do, but you know, usually the people who tend to develop courses tend to have huge established audiences that they can feed it to, right? This allows very small audiences to be monetizable, right? Not necessarily very massive, large ones. And so I still think like for every 300,000 teachable or courses that may be out there, right? You still got another 40 million people who are experts sharing their passion and expertise in one way or another that don't have a course in them yet. Maybe they do later. And I think courses are great. And I hope more people can find their way to packaging their insight. Yeah. But so much of insight has to be tailored to the person for it to be valuable, right?
Yep. Understood. So we have this mystery man in the lower right-hand corner of the screen here who's been quite silent. And Brian, it's good to see you. Welcome back. What's on your mind? You've been following Zealous pretty much, I think, since Zealous was Zealous. So what are your thoughts?
Before Zealous was Zealous.
There was a predecessor that Brian was also playing around with.
I think this is fantastic. Gee, I'm so excited that you've launched this. And John, I think we need to be we need to put our money where our mouth is, so to speak, and become users of Zealous in this regard. I think about community as now a form of commerce, right? And when we use words like monetize, I mean, I get that people want to make money and that we have to be able to convert our audiences, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, one of the things that I think was so quick to just thrive in Clubhouse was the ability to just democratize a conversation on a platform that was easy, if you had an iPhone. But it quickly lost its luster when everybody was an expert. And what I think we need to do now more, and I see this as an opportunity with Zealous, is to cultivate a community of learning and sharing where that learning and sharing isn't demonstrable in how I articulate that insight, but how I take away those insights, right? So it sort of changes the dynamic of the community itself. And so, Greg, what are you seeing as an opportunity to inspire those people who might be, one, there's people who are going to get this right out of the chute. Like, I need to monetize this. And by the way, shoot was a pun that was intended. That for those, Greg used to have a successful startup called Shoot. So we could talk about that later. But what about the people who are intimidated on these platforms that don't realize that they could cultivate a community around the things that they can help people around? You know, I mean, maybe I'm not smart enough because, you know, I don't have a master class, or I'm not extroverted enough to host panels on Clubhouse every single day. But how can I use Zealous to grow a community if I'm not that influencer, but I am a creator?
So that's a great question. And I think, unfortunately, the world stews in imposter syndrome in various forms and shapes. And most people, I think the lens that we unfortunately use to understand expertise in our highly cynical times is still revenue, right? So the people who tend to generate the most revenue tend to be respected as the most influential in a space, right? There's some academic and thought leadership, but only those cohorts tend to appreciate that. Universally, right? We still likely look at like who's successful, whose book is selling the most, who's getting booked to speak the most, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I think what happens in an environment like a Clubhouse is it gives you a lot of at-bats to actually share what you know, right? And you know, what happens is that there's a filtering process that I think is organically happening. There's a lot of bullshit rooms in there without a doubt, right? But for example, like the way I use Clubhouse is only with people that I now know, trust, and have spent like dozens of hours, maybe even hundreds of hours talking alongside to understand who they are, right? And we can all inspire that confidence. We don't have to go this alone, right? Like, you don't have to use Zealous as a person. You can use Zealous as a club. You can use Zealous as a show, right? Like, and go it together so that you don't have to necessarily bear the full brunt of being the expert at everything, right?
Right.
And part of what audio introduced, I think, was back the thing that they tell like founders all the time is when you don't know an answer, say, I don't know. Right. And I think this is what's coming back a little bit. Right. Is that vulnerability is possible because we're building networks of trust again. Right. And those networks, when they want to go further, have an opportunity to leverage something like Zealous to do that in a way that preserves some of that knowledge in a way that deepens the relationships, right? And in a way, more importantly, I guess, to your question, that can be privatized away from the lights.
Wow. Okay, so that maybe I should have joined earlier. More questions.
You should have joined earlier.
All right, so what about yesterday I hosted the first Salesforce session on Spaces, and it was exciting. And I know internally, you know, being part of a large company, there is a pent up demand for basically participating in these new communities. And the thing about it that's so fascinating is that we're having conversations about humanizing that engagement, which kind of goes counter to, let's just say brands in general. They all have style guides. They all have, you can't speak unless you're a trained spokesperson, et cetera. But now brands are really starting to see these as opportunities, one, to be relevant, but two, it's changing the dynamic of how they participate. So how would Zealous, now or in the future, help brands become part of and create these communities in ways that change the dynamic, maybe monetization, but maybe something more meaningful that brands haven't been able to attain over the last couple decades?
That's a really good question. It's one we've been trying to solve for a long time now, right? Like, relationships don't scale like technically, right? But the way they do scale, or the way to achieve scale in relationships, is actually by enlisting more people that share your beliefs and your values, right? And so, you know, at Shoot, even why we're so focused on user-generated content, it was that it provided a way for your customer to be the voice of your brand. And that brand, that voice was way more authentic, way more believable than anything else, right? Now, brands have to like ultimately give way some to understand that they are no more real than the way people perceive them, right? Like all the things you put on your walls and all the things you claim to be don't matter if no one believes you, right? And so you can find people, if you open the doors wide enough, who believe more and more of the things you believe, right? And you will always have people who don't believe 100%. That's okay. That's human nature. So I think like where something like Zealous helps a lot is actually to reduce, take that luster off of brands from these perfectly polished things and opening the doors to all the people inside, right? There's no reason that the product teams, the sales teams, all these other people inside of an organization couldn't be engaging in these small groups, leading others, right? Like sitting next to other people as opposed to in front of them, right? And I think like the more and more brands get into this mindset, number one, it's the only way for them to truly participate in this new evolution of tools, right? But the more they do that, I think the more they will find that the things that they thought they had to be don't matter, right? And the things that do matter will become much more obvious and clear.
Yeah, that's so well said. That's so well said. John, do you want to take anything in terms of last questions? I do think, personally, I'd like to commit us, John, if you're okay with that, to being a partner of Zealous with Intersections. And then also, I do want to have a conversation, Gregarious, with John and you on Clubhouse. And maybe even Twitter Spaces, so that we can take this conversation to where the community is as well. I mean, we're working on building our community as well, but I think that's it's a platform, but also a conversation that needs to be extended to where attention is focused. So I'd like to do that. And then I also want to have another conversation and bring you back in front of the camera to talk about the democratization of cryptocurrency and the rise of creator coins, of which you have recently launched. So
I do have there's, one of those
more, there's more. There's more gregarious.
And they're related. They're related. Creator coins and these learning, new forms of learning platforms, and you know the new social are all intimately stitched together, or can be, you know, with the right point of view.
Yeah, I think they're all different versions of the same thing, right?
Okay. Well, that's helpful.
Social currency. Social currency.
Absolutely. Everything's about currency, right? Like,
yeah, well, absolutely.
I have to fly at the bottom of the hour. I suspect, Brian, that you have 10 other things that you've got to get to.
I will step out and let you guys close the show like normal. So let me.
Namely, lunch.
Lunch. Well, that's a good one, too.
All right. Well, hey, John, thanks for carrying the show at the beginning.
Oh, absolutely. I hope you had a chance to look at the interview with Helen, because it was really pretty terrific.
You know, I was actually really looking forward to this. And my daughter's in Girl Scouts, and I wanted to explore just all kinds of conversations and bringing youth into this discussion as well. And so hopefully we can bring her back. I will watch the show. I was on stage with Coveo talking about the future of relevance in business and how AI can scale relevant engagement across the customer journey. But with that said, John, I know you have to go. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Please watch us on Intersections Live. You got amazing guests in the past. Please subscribe to our newsletter. Please join us every Thursday at 10:30 a.m. Pacific. And do reach out if you have comments or suggestions. Gregarious, if you could take us out with our outro, we will see you all next week.